Blackstone presents The House on the Cliff, The Hardy Boys, Book 2, by Franklin W. Dixon. This book is read by Wayne Evans. Chapter 1, The Haunted House. Three powerful motorcycles sped along the shore road that leads from the city of Bayport, skirting Barmet Bay on the Atlantic coast. It was a bright Saturday afternoon in June, and although the city sweltered in the heat, cool breezes blew in from the bay. Two of the motorcycles carried an extra passenger. All the cyclists were boys of about 15 and 16 years of age, and all five were students at Bayport High School. They were enjoying their Saturday holiday by this outing, glad of the chance to get away from the torrid warmth of the city for a few hours. When the foremost motorcycle reached a place where the shore road formed a junction with another highway leading to the north, the rider brought his machine to a stop and waited for the others to draw alongside. He was a tall, dark youth of 16, with a clever, good-natured face. His name was Frank Hardy. "Where do we go from here?" he called out to the others. The two remaining motorcycles came to a stop and the drivers mopped their brows while the two other boys dismounted, glad of the chance to stretch their legs. One of the cyclists, a boy of 15, fair with light curly hair, was Joe Hardy, a brother of Frank's, and the other lad was Chet Morton, a chum of the Hardy boys. The other youths were Jerry Gilroy and Biff Hooper, typical healthy American lads of high school age. "You're the leader," said Cho to his brother. "We'll follow you." "I'd rather have it settled. We started out without any particular place to go. There's not much fun just riding around the countryside." "I don't care where we go, as long as we keep on going," said Jerry. "We get a breeze as long as we're traveling, but the minute we stop, I begin to sweat." Chet Morton gazed along the shore road. "I'll tell you what we can do," he said suddenly. "Let's go visit the haunted house. Palooka's place." "Sure, we've never been out there."
"I've passed it," Frank said, "but I didn't go very close to the place, I'll tell you."
Jerry Gilroy, who was a newcomer to Bayport, looked puzzled.
"Where's Palooka's place?"
"You can see it from here. Look," said Chet, taking him by the arm and bringing him over to the side of the road. "See where the shore road dips? Away out near the end of Barmet Bay? Do you see that cliff?"
"Yes, there's a stone house at the top."
"Well, that's Palooka's place."
"Who is Palooka?"
"Who was Palooka, you mean," interjected Frank. "He used to live there, but he was murdered.
And that's why the place is supposed to be haunted?"
"Reason enough, isn't it?" said Biff Hooper. "I don't believe in ghosts, but I'll tell the world. There are some funny stories going around about that house ever since Palooka was killed."
"He must have been a strange fellow anyway," commented Jerry, "to build a house in such a place as that."
Indeed, the Palooka place had been built on an unusual site. High above the waters of the bay it stood, built close to the edge of a rocky and inhospitable cliff. It was some distance back from the road, and there was no other house within miles. The boys had traveled a little more than 3 miles since leaving Bayport, and the Palooka place was at least 5 miles away. It could hardly have been seen had it not been for its prominent position on the top of the cliff, silhouetted clearly against the sky. "He was a strange fellow," Frank observed. "No one knew very much about him. He didn't welcome visitors. In fact, he always kept a couple vicious dogs around the place, so nobody cared to hang around if they weren't invited."
"He was a miser," came from Joe Hardy.
"He may have been. At least, that was the theory. Everybody said Palooka had a lot of money. But after his death, there wasn't a nickel found in the house."
"Felix Palooka always said he wouldn't trust the banks," put in Biff Hooper. "But if he had any money, I don't know where he made it, for he didn't work at anything, and he mighty seldom came into the city."
"Perhaps he inherited it," Jerry suggested.
"Maybe. He must have had money at some time to build that house. It's a great rambling stone place that must have cost thousands."
"Is anybody living there now?"
The others shook their head. "No one has lived there since the murder, and I don't think anyone ever will," said Frank Hardy.
The house is too far out of the way, for one thing. And then, the stories that have been going around. Well, I wouldn't say.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.